My name is Michael Wood. Since the age of 17, I've been willing to die in service to my community. In the U.S. Marine Corps, I was Sergeant Wood.
Michael Wood spent 11 years in the Baltimore Police Department.
Michael Wood is a very honest individual. He was not liked by the Baltimore City Police because he didn't play the good old boy network game.
As my career developed, I set out to understand why people offend instead of how they offend.
The reason why these consent decrees don't do anything is because there's no enforcement or changing of the mechanism of incentives for the officers. So all you're doing is talking about it. You're
certainly was going to cross. I was ready to shoot if I had to, but I was never going to cross that line.
But you kind of wanted to shoot.
Sure.
What? Get what you inspect, not what you expect.
Mm-hmm. So or anywhere that's populated, is your metric is based off of arrest. So you don't actually go out and engage with the community because that would be time that you could be getting the arrest that you're expected to get to prove that you're a decent officer. So you actually don't have any incentive to communicate.
Michael, we should be looking for goals to not have people end up in the criminal justice system. Instead, every solution we have is to push them into the criminal justice system.
It should not be up to Jeff Sessions to determine how Baltimore Police Department operates. It should be up to the residents of Baltimore. Jeff Sessions doesn't know anything about policing, never has and never will.
I want to read a quote that you gave the Washington Post, which struck me. You said, when you work in policing, you're inundated early on with the us versus them mentality. It's ingrained in you that this is a war, and if someone isn't wearing a uniform, they're the enemy. It just becomes part of who you are, of how you do your job.
What I'm trying to say is that we are looking at people who are doing nothing new, and if we focus on the actions, then we can fix the things for next time, because when you focus on people, we end up thinking we can chop the head off, they put a new person in, something will change. But if we don't focus on the methodologies
look,
the institutions, then we will be
totally
misguided.
Put them in a prison cell, do the paperwork, go back out, and do it again. So what we really need is to change the incentives and disincentives so that no matter what the role, we're still going towards that objective
There's
that actually
occupation,
serves
occupation, more vehicles, if your answer continues to be violent, because we have to understand that everything about policing is inherently violent. I have come in there with authority and told you what you will do.
All right, so what are we tackling first?
I don't care. I read that article and I kind of like went on a sidetrack, kind of venting to myself about that way that article sparked my typical frustrations. And then that led me down this thing about Obama kicking the can down the street with DACA applicants. So we could even talk about that. And then there is the discussion about postmodernism I wouldn't mind discussing. And then
interesting. Okay.
And then there is the book and what I'm trying to do with that we could even discuss. And this is only going to take me a couple of weeks, so I've just nailed down. I'll give it to you before I pump anything out there, of course. I was thinking about having you write the foreword.
Okay. I mean, do you want to do all of those things in one conversation, or do you want to split them up?
Who the fuck knows? You know how I am, and how any conversation between us goes is we end up fucking talking about and creating an episode for something we didn't even know we were going to discuss anyway. So I have no idea how to manage this thing. That's supposed to be your thing.
All right. Well, let's start with the article that you wrote that you mentioned at the beginning of your rant. Was that the NFL article that we discussed?
No, I was talking about the one that you had me read. That's Fox article.
Oh,
or
that one. Okay.
That.
So that was sent to you by one of our listeners. So let's tackle this first, because the title of this, it's not an article, it's an op-ed, and it's actually it's not on Fox News. We are reading it on foxnews.com, but it was published in the Wall Street Journal.
And so is the Wall Street Journal like somehow significantly different than Fox News that I'm not aware of?
No, I mean not in editorial outlook.
Okay.
It's just to accurately cite the source.
To be clear, because I don't think a lot of that was like kind of news to me when I got into the business management world. I didn't really know that until I started my master's and was getting into things where you look at sources like the Wall Street Journal, and it was like, oh my God, this is like Fox News. I thought it was like a respectable objective thing.
And so the Wall Street Journal, it certainly has historically always been right of center, but it was once upon a time a pretty prestigious and well-regarded publication. Of course, some of that reputation was in an era where media was a little less partisan in terms of the way the audience consumes it. But that was also before Rupert Murdoch took over. And I think the truth is that the editorial page had been trending in an increasingly right direction for some time before that. But after that, you know, the Wall Street Journal really, especially the editorial page, just became nonsense. But anyway, Shelby Steele wrote an opinion piece in the Wall Street Journal titled "Why the Left Can't Let Go of Racism." And essentially, you know, it starts off by asking the question, is America racist? And then it defines racism. It says it used to be that racism meant the actual enforcement of bigotry, which I suspect neither you or I would accept as the definition of racism. But
does that race definition exist anywhere other than this article?
Well, I think actually my experience is that people on the right, this is one of their discursive strategies. They generally frame racism in this way, or they frame it as a belief in races at all when they want to kind of go down the colorblind universalism road. They say that if you believe in races, then that's racism. And so we just don't talk about races, and that's how you end racism, right? And so that's one strategy. But this is another one where you say racism is just the legal enforcement, let's say, of racist beliefs. So things like Jim Crow segregation. And then
does that limit racism to codified laws then?
Essentially, yeah. And so you can see why that's an effective strategy. If you can get the other person to not object to that definition, then you've kind of got them boxed in where you can now say, well, you know, Civil Rights Act passed in the 60s, and so there's no more racism, right? And, you know, it even uses, it even has a line here that says, white racism did not shoot more than 4,000 people last year in Chicago, which is,
We all know how much that line always infuriates me when you don't even bother to trace the line of why these things happen and all the presumptions that you come up with in that statement that are just simply false premises to begin with.
Yeah, it's hard to know where to start, but I guess the gist of the piece is that the left won't let go of racism. You know, it wants to believe, okay, I guess it has something to fix in America's soul. It's kind of nonsense, but I thought we could maybe start with how we think about the question of racism, the definition of racism, what that means. And so I thought I'd start with you on that.
Okay, so we can start with the beginning of racism, and we can throw in a little thing where I will give in to that if there's something nice to say about the writing, that there is a weird thing where the left hangs on to the constructs of race as a base for their argument, and activism becomes a history contest instead of a solution contest, which I discuss often. I will give that, like, there is something there that they're kind of hitting on in that weird way. Like, Portland stands out to me as an exceptional example of that concept.
Okay. I think I agree with you, though I take a slightly different take on it, but we can get to that aspect later.
Sure. So how I would define race is that I think racism is using race under a power structure to enforce the classification, oppression, or lessering of others. That is why I do subscribe to, like, racism involves a power structure where you're actually effective at a widespread societal change towards something that is tangible and measurable that you can actually see. So when somebody is prejudiced, then yeah, it has the same outcomes. Like racism and prejudiceness have their same base. It's just when you have prejudice applied to a power structure and you are basing that solely on race, and that's racism.
So I differ slightly in my definition in that I divorce the question of racism from the question of the power structure. And this I do because in my study of ancient Christian thought, I have focused on the question of the way Christians treated non-Christian others, which generally meant polytheistic Greeks or Jewish persons. And there's a tendency in early Christian scholarship to treat what would otherwise be viewed as sort of anti-Semitic statements on the parts of Christians as qualitatively different depending on this question of political power, this question of whether the statement is made before or after the Roman Emperor Constantine made Christianity essentially the principal religion of the empire. So statements that are identical and identically problematic about Jewish persons in particular are treated as completely qualitatively different. And considering the historical consequences of that rhetoric, of those discourses, extending all the way into the 20th century with the Holocaust, I don't think, from my perspective, that we can excuse those sentiments prior to Christianity having political power after Constantine. I don't think we can let those statements off the hook. So I don't want to tie the question of racism strictly to the question of political power. I think for me, the question of racism is defined by whether or not the norms that govern a given situation are defined exclusively from the perspective of a self-defined race, which I think in the case of racism, that is an accurate way to put the way it works, and the enforcement of that, and not just necessarily the political or legal enforcement of that, but the enforcing of who gets a say in the norms that dictate any given situation.
And my pushback to that, while I understand it, would be that whether the statement is problematic before or after there's a power exchange, it could have been problematic in the fact that the power doesn't necessarily need to be political power. It could also be some kind of social construct of power that is different, a mob mentality kind of thing where the power can be different within that subculture, but also that the power of the prejudiceness. So it's prejudiceness without the power, the racism, and why it is, it's what makes it worse and makes it a greater evil than pure prejudice.
Yeah, no, I mean, I agree that once you attach or couple power to it, that it becomes a much more dangerous thing, you know. But the problem is that, you know, that other side or that other way of thinking about power, which is, you know, say using the Christian analogy, who has authority in the early Christian church even prior to Constantine to speak, right? And the fact that it is only Christian voices speaking to other Christians about what the Jews are essentially or what polytheistic Greeks are essentially. And so there is a power structure there in terms of who has authority and who gets to define who is what. But I think that it is that discursive violence, that violence of language, that then enables it, whether it's attached to broader political hegemony or not, the question of physical and other forms of violence. So for me, I just can't make power the crux. You know, I think racism obviously is tied to the concept of race as it's been articulated in our Western context, biologistically, I think is the word, but I tie it more to who gets to define the norms in a given situation, especially because that extends beyond just the legal context.
Right, but isn't that power? So that would be power as the ability to define the history and set that course of history. So I really don't think we're having a different argument. I think what we're really talking about is there's prejudice based upon race and there's prejudice based upon race plus power. And I'm calling that prejudice and racism, and you're calling that racism and then racism plus.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Okay, so I don't think we're actually arguing different points. We're just arguing.
No, yeah, I mean, this is the nuance. This is how.
It's like if this is an algebra equation, you define x as something, and I'm defining x as something, but it's still x.
They're both still x. But,
right.
But I just, you know, I wouldn't say racism or racist discourse as we know it, because in some ways the idea that racism has to be tied to explicit political power is the argument this author in the Fox News Wall Street Journal piece is making, right? Is that if we've dismantled the legal structure of racism, you know, through something like the Civil Rights Act, then it doesn't matter that
nonsense.
No, which is nonsense. The idea that we've done that, but the premise is that if we've done that, then racist sentiments against some percentage of individuals isn't the same as racism still exists, right? And I don't think either of us would agree with that. And so I just don't want to. I think that the question of racism and the problematic of racism can't just be limited to when the racist has political or legal supremacy. It's a problem either way.
Yeah, I feel like it's also founded on this basic idea of almost like a pulling up kind of the ladder idea you get on the right end of the spectrum a lot, where they want to like make the argument that it's a level playing field if you stop kicking somebody, right? So it's like once they're up and they pull up the ladder and they go, what, we're now equal. And then if you have racism and you have abuses within your structure, and then you say, well, we're going to stop it. So it's based on the idea of we've stopped it and we've created level. But you can't, like, beat somebody down, lower them on everything, and then call it even. Like, that's not how even works.
No, not at all.
Or, you know? So that's, like, this flawed premise from the beginning.
No, yeah, and this speaks to something that, you know, in our context, legally, the approach the Supreme Court has taken to questions of race has kind of been to adopt the exact view that you just expressed, which is like, all right, like there's not legal segregation or legal racism anymore from their perspective. And so racism is essentially over, right? And so even a policy like affirmative action, you can't pursue, because that would, one, use the law to codify the idea of race because it privileges certain racial groups over another by definition. And therefore, that's problematic because that's a sort of perpetuation of the legal idea of race. Whereas, say, in a context like South Africa, their Supreme Court has ruled post-apartheid that it is not enough for the law to promise essentially equal treatment and to eliminate race from consideration, but that the law has to also correct for the centuries of oppression and for the centuries of disenfranchisement. And so the American legal context and American jurisprudence doesn't take that perspective up to this point. Some other contexts have understood that truth, that exactly like you said, you can't like beat someone to a pulp and then you stop beating them and say, now we're both being treated equally. It's like, well, no, this guy needs serious medical attention. And until that person is restored to health, you can't say you're on a level playing field.
Yeah, and I think you bring up another point in how the legal system and that kind of mentality can fit into our cultural norms and become something we just accept without thinking about it.
Yeah.
As this race blindness is what we're kind of taught, especially in white rural America where I grew up, and that I admit everybody can go back to years, you know, go back to some of the first writings I had in public and the first speeches I had in public, is that belief in racial blindness was like my fatal error. That I was trying to do everything right, trying to be professional, and one of those cruxes I thought was to be racially blind and enforce the actions as the system said we should, and then if we didn't see it, then things would be fine, and that made me end up acting. My actual actions were objectively racist because I was not acknowledging the race of where the system had put me and told me to do.
Yeah, and that is exactly it, right? You end up still with objectively racist both actions and results when you decide to take a colorblind approach. It, when the colorblind premise just isn't valid.
Right. And this is acknowledged in the writings here when, I don't know if it's male or female, Shelby's kind of ambiguous, but in rebuttal to the claim that there is systemic racism, she makes, or he or she makes it up to be like a claim saying that it's the left is just making it up. He claims that it's systemic racism and institutional racism is just something made up, and then says, quote, "It was plain to the objective investigators that the deaths of Trayvon Martin and Michael Brown had nothing to do with race hatred." Right. Because their actions, this can be true, that neither Trayvon's killer or Michael Brown's killer had conscious racist actions. They have been and conditioned by a systemically institutionalized racist culture and system that pushed them to these outputs, unaware of it them very selves. That's what systemic racism does.
But also notice what the author has done. And whether this was intentional or not, he has changed the definition of racism that he offered at the beginning so that he can make this other point, right? In the beginning, racism was the actual enforcement of bigotry. Now racism is personal racial animus of the officer. And so which one was it, right? Because suddenly in the case of Michael Brown, right, you could argue that hit Michael Brown's killing by Officer Darren Wilson was exactly the actual enforcement of bigotry. And then, you know, if you read the report by the Justice Department about Ferguson, it's hard to disagree that in Ferguson, racial bigotry was actually enforced by law enforcement officers and by criminal justice practices. But, you know, I want the audience just to notice how the way you define or frame the premise or define racism in these two examples from the article, right? They switch it on you so that they can make a given point. And they've essentially argued two different definitions to make a point that only their framing allows it. It's not an actually justified conclusion.
Yeah, I feel like you go down these same paths that I start going down, and you make me like chomp at the bit because I'm like, that's where, like, no, that's exactly what I was thinking. Is like right down those lines is that part of this is like, it's systemic of this whole bigger idea in that these people, they're not thinkers or actual intellectuals. I feel like it's shameful that we have to even discuss such juvenile philosophies. Like, these things are not curated by any type of thinking. Like, this, imagine seeing this in scientific literature that's peer-reviewed. I mean, not only is it not thought out, like, they cite some magical knowledge of even what really happened to Trayvon and Mike Brown. Like, the only thing that an objective investigator could say about either of those cases is, I don't know, because part of the tragedy of those two situations is that we don't know what happened because systemic racism acted out in such a way to cover it so we can never even investigate the truth. And these type of weak arguments get this attention because of this system being in the very media itself, and that is the fact that so many people even find this interesting is an indictment on how this seeps into our educational system, that they can't point out basic contradictions within paragraph to paragraph.
No, yeah. So here
Sorry
we are.
Sorry for the rant.
No, I mean, that's ranting is what nuance is all about. But no, I mean, I think you're exactly right. So I think we can conclude this episode by saying, you know, if you've been reading the Wall Street Journal, don't fret. You don't have to let go of racism just yet, all you leftists out there. You can still hold on to it because it's still a problem and we're still in the process of deconstructing it and its consequences. This has been another episode of Nuance, a production of On Background Media Incorporated for StayUp.News. Intro and outro music provided by Baltimore's God Sends Beats. If you are a regular listener, please consider supporting our work, which you can do for as little as $1 a month. Simply go to patreon.com/StayUpNews, StayUpNews, all one word, and select your monthly donation and reward tier. Again, that is patreon.com/StayUpNews. On behalf of myself and Michael Wood Jr., thank you again for listening.